we get to worship, how about we turn around, say good morning to somebody near you, and then I'll call you back. Thank you. Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body
The book of Psalm 126. In case you were wondering, it's one of my favorite psalms. Not that that matters to you, but it is. You can laugh at that. Psalm 126 says this: When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. And then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongues with shouts of joy. Then they said amongst the Treasure Valley, then they said amongst Nampa and Meridian and Boise and Star and Middleton, come on, and they said in Idaho, and then they said in the United States, and they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We will be glad. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the streams in the Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. Man, I believe in this moment the Spirit of God is restoring joy back to some of you today. Some of you, you've been robbed, and the enemy has strategically come after your joy. And I'm here to tell you today that God is restoring the joy of your salvation, the joy of knowing him intimately, the joy of no longer taking his presence for granted. Come on, the Spirit of God is in this place, and that which the enemy meant to kill, steal, and destroy, God is turning for good. And there are hopes and dreams that you have just died to. There are dry bones in the room that God is bringing back to life. It's not a mustard up happiness. It's not a mustard up just, oh, I got to put a smile on my face. No, but God is returning a smile on your face. He's allowing hope to arise once again, that faith would arise again. Those things which you once left dormant and you said they're dead, God, I lay them down. God's here to bring back to life that which he is called to be restored and redeemed by him. Come on. Come on, some of you, you've just been giving in. You've been giving in to the fact that just, well, I lost it. Whatever it may be, maybe it's a dream. Maybe it's your joy. Maybe it's hope. Come on, and you've just kind of been all right with settling for that. And I want to remind you, we have a God that restores. I want to remind your soul today, we have a God that is an expert at bringing things back to life. He's an expert at taking that which looks lost and broken and hopeless and doing what only he can do, and bringing hope into the situation. Come on, I want you to walk out of here today with a new skip in your step, with a new smile on your face, to know I got a God that's for me, he is with me, I'm not alone. Come on, this isn't just positive speak, this is the word of God for you today. And we've got a reason to worship him, do we not? Not just because of what he's done, but who he is, merits praise and worship and adoration, and us bowing down before the King of Kings, because my friend, the King is in the room today. He is here, and his glory, it says, will cover like the waters cover the ocean, so shall his glory cover the earth. Come on. I feel a word of the Lord for your friends, Sue. What are their names? Susie and Christine. So, hey, if you're new, if you're visiting us, sometimes we just feel like, we know God still speaks to us today. And so I've just got a word for you two ladies, and that was just, you guys are friends of Sue and Warren, okay? And here's the other thing I know, is that when I went to go say hi to you guys, I just felt the word increase. I just kept hearing the word increase. I feel like God's going to increase your opportunity in ministry. He is increasing also your capacity. So he's got to make you big on the inside first before you can do bigger things on the outside. So he's doing something in you right now to increase your capacity. He's going to use you in a greater way. I just believe there's going to be an increase of favor, an increase of opportunities, more doors that will be open. And I don't know what that means for you guys, but I just believe God is bringing an increase on your ministry. And he's reminding you to be faithful to what he's put in your hands right now. Be faithful in what's in your hands right now, and he will bring forth the increase. So, Father, in Jesus' name, whatever is yours and whatever came from you, God, we are going to believe that. And we're just going to trust, God, that you're going to take anything that maybe I could be off on, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys still have some worship left in you? Okay, hey, let's lift our hands to heaven. Let's just begin to say, God, your name is great. We're going to glorify his name a little longer this morning, okay? Come on, oh, praise the name.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God.
Go on and pray.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God.
For
endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God.
Father, we thank you for your presence in this place, oh God. We thank you, Father, because no matter who we are, where we come from, what we've done, where we are even today on our journey of life and faith, you are a good God that meets every individual right where they are at. Thank you for meeting us here this morning. We pray now, God, that as we turn our attention and our affection as well towards your word, God, you would speak to us clearly. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on, high five your neighbor on your way down. Tell him it's a good day to be in church. It's a good day to be in church. Awesome. Hey, welcome, welcome. If we have not had a chance to meet yet, my name is Tony, and my wife and I are privileged to be the lead pastors here at Legacy. If you are visiting us for the very first time, we want to say welcome. We hope that you feel like a guest and not just a visitor. Part of you feeling like a guest is we want to get to know you and connect with you. So if you don't mind doing us a favor and filling out a connect card, that's going to be located in the seat back in front of you. And then once you've filled that out, you can head over to the lobby after church, and there's a banner that says, "Are you new here?" And there will be a really nice smiling face there that will take that from you and follow up with you. The rest of you, before we jump into today's message, I got a couple things I want to talk to you about. If you have not yet picked up your volunteer t-shirt for this next weekend, how many of you felt like Easter weekend kind of snuck up on us a little bit? Anybody? Some of you had no idea it's Easter next weekend, okay? And if that's the case, you've been sleeping under a rock, okay? Just want to welcome you to the real world. No, and so want to remind you next Friday, so this Friday, stay with me, this Friday, we've got our Good Friday service at 6:30. And I want to just remind you that you want to get here early for that. It's just one service and one service alone, so it can get pretty full pretty quickly. So get here early. It's an hour of a moment of reverence and as we reflect on the death of Jesus. Then Saturday, we are loving on our community. And so if you signed up for the Easter egg hunt to volunteer there, you want to swing by the booth at the end to go get your shirt, which was designed by Pastor Sophia, okay? This is awesome. So if you signed up to volunteer, you got to get one. And then now that you're looking at it, you're like, I kind of want one. Well, good thing that you want one because here's an opportunity to get one. If you have not yet signed up to help us out at the Easter egg hunt, you can swing by that t-shirt booth and help, sign up to volunteer. But in addition to that, as you know, we don't have one service, we don't have two services, we have three services next weekend for Easter. And so with that, man, we would love for you to have one service where you invite a friend and you sit with them. Another one, you can just like sit by yourself and enjoy the service, because how many of you know it's a different experience when you bring a friend? It's a little more anxiety in that. And then another service you can serve at. So if you today sign up to serve at any of those three services, you too could get a shirt. And so we would love for you to jump in. Man, how many of you are excited to be in the house of God this morning? Did you know that there's literally no place that I would rather be than in the house of God? And I mean it. Our family took a little break last week. We went on vacation. How many know spring break is a kind of a little shot in the arm for a breather, right? And then you're already looking forward to summer. But we took a little bit of a breather, left town for a couple days too. But can I tell you, there's no place like home. And for me, home is the house of God. And so you're at the right place here this morning. I hope you're not in a hurry, because God's got something for you today. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Would you grab your Bible? Would you stand to your feet? And we're gonna say, this is my Bible. It's the Word of God. I'm gonna let it mold me. I'm gonna let it direct me. Amen. Stay standing, and open up to the book of Matthew, chapter 21. And it says this, now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, by the way, found in Zechariah chapter 9, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you. Humble, say with me, humble.
Humble,
humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did just as Jesus had directed them. Come on, how many of you know that obeying what Jesus says is a good idea? And they brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Verse 9, and the crowds that went before him and that had followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, as we have sang today. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. Father, I thank you for your word. I pray now you would illuminate, God, our path. Help us, Lord, no matter where we're at today, to not just be hearers, but also doers of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. How many of you have vivid nightmares? Anyone like me where, like, you wake up and you can actually remember the details? Some of us are so, I'm not going to insult you by saying what I wouldn't call myself, but so weird in the brain, let's say, that our brain never stops and our imagination never stops. So I actually have really vivid, kind of scary sometimes, dreams. And if you know me, you know that I really enjoy running, and that's part of why I'm a little crazy. It's just that I actually enjoy running. Anyone else out there actually enjoy running? Come on, there's two hands out of 300 of you. That's awesome. Exactly. The rest of you actually just endure it. Am I right? You just kind of like endure running. Some of us love running, and I grew up running, and as I've gotten older, I've challenged myself to run longer miles. And so last year, some of you may know this, and you're already laughing at the fact that I'm using another running analogy, but just bear with me. Last year, I ran my first half marathon. I've got another half marathon coming up in May of this year. And part of that is I'm actually just like building up the miles, because one of the goals I have is when I'm 40, I want to start running a full marathon every year until I'm 50. That's kind of a lifelong goal that I've got. And so the other night I had a terrible nightmare about this marathon that is coming up in May, and that is this, that I slept through my alarm, so I'm like rushing out the door. I don't get a chance to have breakfast or, you know, intake water or, you know, go to the restroom, you know, all any of that stuff. And so I just get in my truck, and in the dream, I'm driving like 100 miles an hour into Boise, right, from Nampa, to just try to get there on time. And on the way there, I hit a deer. And because I'm in a rush, I just peel the deer carcass off. I take a bite out of it for protein and like get back into the car, and I just keep on driving, right? And so I'm rushing. I get there, I check in, and it's the beginning of the race, and you know, the gunman says, you know, runners take your marks. And as I take my marks and I look down in my nightmare, I am naked. Some of you came to church and you're like, is this allowed to be talked about in church? I don't know. And so I look down, I'm like, oh my goodness, right? And I'm literally the emperor with no clothes. And so I've got no clothes on. And I'm like, so in my weird dream, I get back into the truck and I drive home to get some clothes, right? And so I drive home, and when I pull up to our house, it has been burned to the ground. I mean, we're talking, it's just embers and ash, right, everywhere. And so I'm like digging through the rubble, and I find these 4-inch inseam running shorts. So I put them on, get back in the truck, go, and somehow I make it over to the starting line again. And when I show up, I'd missed it. I'd missed the start, and I missed the race, and woke up profusely sweating, and realized, thankfully, it was just a nightmare, but I missed the gun. Here's where I'm going with this. As we look to Easter, as we look to celebrate this wonderful resurrection and victorious moment that Jesus had, my hope is that we wouldn't miss the person that we are celebrating. That we wouldn't get lost in all of the, it's beautiful and it's right and it's good that we're going to reach out to our community and we're going to do all these, you know, some of you raw in the fingers because you've been stuffing eggs all week long, you know, with candy, and I get that, but here's my hope in my heart is that after all this preparation, we would miss the man, Jesus. And that in all the lights and all the glamours and all the thing that we look to as believers, that we would not miss the essence of the man, Jesus. And today historically marks what's traditionally known as Holy Week. Palm Sunday, also known as the triumphal entry of Jesus, where we begin to now look towards the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. And my friend, I don't want you to miss it. Don't miss the meaning of a God that loved you so much that though he knew no sin, would literally become sin so that you and I, sinners, would become the righteousness of the Father. My hope is that in the hustle and bustle that we wouldn't get to this point and miss that Jesus is here now right in front of us. And it's interesting to me how on this triumphal entry of Jesus, by the way, this is his moment, right? This is his moment where he's finally going, I am who some of you have suspected I am. And for you haters, no matter whether you believe it or not, I still am who I am. And so he shows up, and though he's declaring who he is, he shows up in a way that seemingly, say with me, seemingly might be surprising. And so as we look at this monumental moment in not just scripture, but history, and also in our walk of faith, we must understand one thing, and that is this. The way we view Palm Sunday will forever affect how we view Jesus and who he is. Because the way he showed up on the scene tells us so much about who he is. First thing I want to talk to you about as it relates to this passage is this, is we will miss out on the now if we only wait for the next. If we are so focused on what's coming next, we will miss out on the now. And we see here in the book of Matthew, chapter 21, verse 5, say to the daughter of Zion, by the way, quoting Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, behold, your king is coming to you humble. Say with me, humble. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. Some people missed what was right in front of them. You know, because the procession of a king should have historically been on a high horse. By the way, this is where we get this saying, right? Get off your high horse is what you say to somebody who thinks too highly of themselves. Traditionally speaking, culturally speaking, a king's procession would mean a large horse, 18 to 20 hands, if you will. But Jesus, he shows up on a donkey. Y'all ever seen Shrek? Come on, Shrek. He shows up on a, and not only does he show up on a donkey, track with me, he shows up on a baby donkey. Oh, and if that's not humble enough for you, he didn't even own the donkey. It was a borrowed baby donkey. Almost as if to show us who he is. This humble, gentle, and lowly servant. And because of this, I believe some of them missed it. Why? Because they wanted something bigger. And how many of us have fallen in the trap on constantly waiting for what's next that we miss out on the now? And I want to call your attention today to this. Man, do not wish away the season in which you are in today. Come on, young parents, let me talk to you for a second. Man, don't wish away those poopy diapers and the spit up and the interrupted nights of sleep. God's trying to do something in you in the now. Come on, those of you that maybe you finally have raised your kids, now you're just looking forward to retirement. What is God doing now? And if we are so focused on what's next, we will miss out on the now. And can I tell you, this is way more simple than we like to make it. Living in the now, Jesus actually tells us, hey, don't worry about tomorrow. It's got its own concerns and worries. But hey, if we're honest, most of us live somewhere between regretting our past and feeling anxious about the future. And God's calling us to the now. Now, of course, let me balance this by saying, of course, it's good for us to, I mean, the Bible still teaches who would go and build something without first planning. Absolutely. But we have lived in a culture that pushes the future so much that we have lost our ability to be present. And when we do, we miss out on who's in front of us and what's in front of us. And can I tell you, that means people sometimes. There are people, hear me on this, church, there are people in your life today that you've overlooked because you're too busy looking for what's next instead of what's now. And there are people and there are circumstances in our life that you've kind of overlooked because, yeah, it doesn't matter. And God's going, I want to do something in you now, today, in you here. Come on, some of you have actually dared, some of us, can I say this, have dared and complained about the very miracle we're currently living in right now that back then we could only muster up some faith to beg God for. And now we're living in it and we are daring to complain about it because it's not the way we thought it would be. Jesus rescues and works and saves in ways that we oftentimes not only miss and understand, but sometimes outright refuse to see. And can I tell you this? They shouldn't have been surprised by how Jesus showed up. I missed this first service. I'm going to say it to you. Second service. The people that recognized who Jesus was because they had history of his faithfulness. Number one, they recognized the prophet has already said the Messiah will show up on a donkey. So they shouldn't have been surprised. Not only that, they would have had the history of their ancestors to tell them King Solomon entered in the same way. And so the people that, hear me, recognized, knew who he was based on who he said he was. Did you know that God's character is always true and he never changes his mind? The problem is we don't see things the way he sees things, and so we miss it at times. Turn to your neighbor today like an old school church and go, don't miss it. Don't miss it. You know, culture has taught us to judge a book by its cover. Am I right? By the way, I just got to tell you this. Some of y'all have no idea what a book even is, and I just want to encourage you, go get a book. Like, go to the library. It's free. Go to the library. And that's how we do it, right? Like, we choose books based on, like, the graphics and what they look like, right? We do this with clothing. Some of you don't read ingredients. You just buy food that's packaged a certain way. Your favorite soda, your favorite drink, right? If it's packaged cool, then I'll get it. And Jesus comes in a different package. And so because he comes in a different package, we miss him. And so many times what God's trying to do has more to do with the now than not just the next. Now, absolutely, like I said, I want to balance this by telling you, absolutely, it's good for you to prepare for the future. It's good for you to be responsible and to look. But when we only wait for what's next, we miss what God's trying to do in the now. You know, I got to say something else to my generation. Is that okay? Let me just say it to everybody, actually, because some of y'all are sinners like my generation, too. Because we're so focused on what's next, we miss out and we actually wiggle out of the processes that he wants to take us through in the now. And so, because it's hard, because it's difficult, because it's not easy, because it's uncomfortable, which, by the way, I understand in 2024, uncomfortable is almost a cuss word now, right? Because we live in a literal comfort crisis where everything, so if it's a little uncomfortable, by the way, I'm going to go in a little bit. If church is uncomfortable, if the pastor makes me feel uncomfortable, if the word of God makes me, I try to wiggle out. And I'm telling you, may we not be the kind of people that are so focused on what's next, God. What are you going to promote me to that we miss out on what he's trying to do in the now in us? Am I talking to somebody today? Those that did recognize that he was the Messiah, the King of Kings, they had the history to look back on and go, we recognize who this man is. And you know what they did? They laid down palm branches, which, by the way, a palm tree in the Hebrew, the word is Tamar or Tamar, and this is what it signified. It symbolized blessing, health, and prosperity. Let me talk to you modern Christians today, living here in the Western world. We have glorified blessing. We have glorified preparation. We have glorified health and future health. And we have greatly glorified future prosperity. Yet these people laid that down. It's interesting to me that when he was who they wanted him to be, right? A king who was going to come in and overthrow governments. They laid down their blessing, their prosperity, their health. They laid it down. But then, hear me, but then when he gave them not just what they wanted, but what they needed in the way he was going to do it, they traded those palms for a crown of thorns. My question to you is, when you lay those things down, when you recognize who he is, how do you respond? How do we respond to the presence of the Savior in the room? Do we go silent? Do we just kind of like disregard it? Do we just kind of treat it like it's nothing? Or do we, like the psalmist in Psalm 107, as a response, by the way, to salvation and redemption pre-cross, which is incredible to me, says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble. And he goes on and on and on. But I wonder how many of us stay silent. I wonder how many of us maybe don't even recognize that he's here, because he showed up in a way that we were not expecting. Or in a way, hear me, life doesn't look the way we want it to look, so we miss out on what he has for us now. My second question to you today, though, is, will we empty ourselves of ourselves? Are we willing to lay our own pride, our own expectations, our own perspectives down? You know, we're reading in Matthew's account of what took place in Jesus' triumphal entry. And if you're new to the Bible, there's four men that walked with Jesus: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And those are known as the Gospels. They're the four books in the New Testament. And it's interesting to me how these four men that walked with Jesus all kind of have their own different perspective of what took place. Anybody else know that that's how it works? Sometimes, like right now in my house, I'm raising five kids. Same two parents, same household. Guarantee you, when they're older, their perspective of their childhood is going to be completely different than their siblings, right? I'm not going to mention names, but I got a kid right now who's like, oh, we don't do enough compared to so-and-so. Meanwhile, I got another kid that's going, I can't believe we get to do all that we do, right? Paula is sitting right here in the front row. She's actually my sister. For those of you that didn't know that, we try to keep that incognito, but she's my sister, and believe it or not, she's older than me, even though I'm wiser and more mature. Listen, I'm at least taller. Some of you are falling asleep. I had to make you laugh. You know, we were raised by the same two parents, under the same roof, under the same conditions, right? And for her, for example, our parents, we traveled a lot when we were younger. They were missionaries. And so her perspective is, I was ripped from my home. I was ripped from my friends. I had to learn how to make new friends. Right? I'm exaggerating it. My perspective is, what's our next adventure? We got to meet more people, and we got to see new things. But there's different perspectives, right? And so let me read to you what Mark's perspective of this account is. Mark, in the 11th chapter, verse 7 through 8, says, and they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it. I want you to just, they threw their cloaks on it. I'm going to explain something to you in a second. And he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Their cloaks in this civilization and culture symbolized status. They emptied themselves of what society would say about them, the work that they had gotten to do so that they could get to a position. They stripped themselves of that. They laid on the road for him to walk through. And not only that, they put it on a donkey for him to sit his you-know-what on. Oh, but Tony, you should see the family I've worked hard for. Tony, you have no idea how I've climbed the corporate ladder. This business I built from the ground up. You should have seen where I come from. I started from the bottom, now I'm here. we willing to empty ourselves of ourselves and not only lay down our status, our security, our pride, and all the things that we clothe ourselves in, and not just lay it down, but go, God, you do with it as you wish. Walk on it. Sit on it. Are we willing to literally take off our status, our security, our own accolades, our pride, whatever we clothe ourselves in, to simply let the King of Glory in? More questions for us today. What are we clothed in that we must empty ourselves of? Some of us, it's control. Some of us, it's fear, doubts, pride, selfishness. Here's another cuss word in 2024, self-preservation. Maybe we've got to empty ourselves of the need to always be right. The need to look good at all times and come out on top no matter what. Maybe we're the ones that are being called to get off our high horse. Maybe we're the ones that are to follow not only after the model that Jesus gave, because by the way, he emptied himself of himself. He emptied himself of himself. In fact, he tells his disciples, the cup I'm going to drink, you can't even fathom to take a sip from this cup, because it requires emptying all that you are. This is God, you guys. I don't know if some of you get it yet, but so let me try to help you get there. He who knew no sin becomes sin so that you and I, who consistently sin, would become the righteousness of the Father. And we're going to talk about this next week, but there's a moment where Jesus is hanging on the cross. And he cries out to the Father and he asks him why he has forsaken him. Theologians would argue that that is the moment where all of the wrath of sin had come upon Jesus. And because God the Father cannot relate with sin, he has to remove his face from looking down at his own son. Are we willing to empty ourselves of ourselves? You know what's crazy to me? These people did it in front of everybody. Hosanna! I don't know if you get it, but in a society like that, to remove clothing in front of anyone, so in front of everybody, they're like, in front of their friends, in front of their peers, in front of authorities, they strip themselves, get naked and humble in front of everybody. Let me challenge you today. Some of you are relating with Jesus like this. Hope nobody saw that. Yep. I'm a spiritual person. Yeah, like I give money here and there, and kind of like I read this historical book. It's like yoga, kale, and Jesus. Are you willing, in front of everybody, go all in? Here's a beautiful thing, though. You ready for some good news? The beautiful thing is when we empty ourselves of ourselves, he never leaves us empty. You know what's so beautiful about our God? Is you come to him, and you begin to empty yourself of your... He doesn't just go, oh, finally, cool, now you're on your way. No, in fact, it's like, sweet. Now there's room for my spirit. Now there's room for me to operate in you. And come on, I know I said this last week. I want to say it again because this is who we are. But the secret sauce, okay? You loved worship today, did you not? Like you felt something. Like you encountered something today. It wasn't just songs. The secret sauce is the Holy Spirit of God operating in and within a people. And so where and how will the Spirit of God operate if we're so full of ourselves? Turn to your neighbor. Say, get over yourself. Turn to your other neighbor. Go, no, but for real, get over yourself. I'm just making you laugh for a little bit. As we empty ourselves of ourselves, we allow the Spirit of God to now dwell within us. And my friend, maybe the talk of the Holy Spirit for some of you is weird. It's not the Holy Spirit that's weird. It's people that are weird, first of all. And we make them weird. The Holy Spirit is the secret sauce to an empowered life. To a way that goes, God, I'm not going to operate out of my own understanding and my own reaction and my own way of thinking. I want to operate out of yours. And now I die to my sin. I die to myself. And now I'm alive in you. And let me tell you, there's nothing better than being alive, truly alive. And I want to just tell you today, if you've yet to encounter the presence of the living God, I say this all the time, go to your prayer closet and don't come out till you do. I'm telling you, it'll change your life. Third and final point, we got to land the plane here pretty soon, about 10-ish to 20 minutes. Third thing that Palm Sunday teaches us, and you've read this on our website, you've heard it here before. Today I want to preach it to you, and that is this. It is okay to not be okay. You know what's beautiful? And I think I want to kind of add, just like when we empty ourselves of ourselves, he doesn't leave us empty. When we show up to Jesus and we're not okay, the other beautiful thing about him is he doesn't leave us that way. So I almost want to say, it's okay to not be okay, and he won't let you leave that way. Oh, that rhymes. Oh, I'm about to like, I mean, should I start freestyling, Jeff? Okay. You know, you don't even know, you guys. I'm using so much self-control right now. I'm using self-control. It is okay to not be okay. But like, hear me. Are you actually able to recognize that you're not okay, though? Because if it's okay to not be okay, we must first understand that we're not okay. Look at Matthew 21:9. And the crowds that went before him that had followed him were shouting. By the way, people, I don't have time, but the people that followed him were people that recognized they needed him. Okay? They shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The word Hosanna, I know at pre-service prayer, Pastor Paul already broke it down, and then Sophia talked about it during worship, but let me just reiterate what's been said. The meaning of Hosanna literally means, oh, save me. It's a cry of salvation. The direct translation would be a command to bring about or to cause salvation. It's a people going, please, I beseech you, save us now. And did you know there's a cry in every heart in this room today? There is a cry in every heart in this room today. But my question is, what will your heart's cry be? I got this, God. Hey, I'll tell you when I need you. Hey, God, thanks. You saved me. I'm good now. Like, let me just kind of do my thing now. Or is it, please, I beseech you, come and save me. Luke 19:39. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples. He said, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. the spiritual people were saying, tell them to stop asking you for help. Shoo them away. They did it with kids. They did it with women. They did it with... Here's where I'm going. In order to say that we are not okay, are we willing to recognize that we actually need rescuing? Are you willing to recognize you need rescuing? Always. Come on, I want my heart's cry to not be, why God? I don't want my heart's cry to be, why me? Why now? I don't want my heart's cry to be, oh, I got this, God. I'll call you when I really need you. No, I want my heart's cry at every moment to be, I beseech you, come and save me. But you guys want to know something about Tony? I don't like being human. No, but I mean it. I detest being a human. Because it means I'm limited. I wish I would. Anybody else out there? Come on, yeah. I know some of you type A are right there with me. The rest of you are like, you are weird. Yes. Like, okay, a couple weeks ago, I got sick. And if you didn't know, I have an autoimmune disease. So it makes it a little harder for me to recover from like the simplest of things. It takes a little longer. I hate that. I hate having to stay in bed and seemingly not be effective and like not do anything. Hate it. Come on, parents. I hate being exhausted. Anybody? Any other parent out there with bags under their eyes? Some of you grandparents need to call up your kids and rescue them every once in a while. I just don't like it. I really don't. I'm being honest with you guys. I really don't like being limited. I don't like that I have limitations. I don't like, ultimately, here's what it is. I don't like recognizing that I need saving. And here's what I know, is that if you're anything like me, you got flesh over those bones, and you got a heartbeat in your chest, you too don't like to recognize that you need help. You want to know why? Because we've lived in a society. And by the way, if I ever preach something that goes against the society, that means we're on to something good. We're called to be in this world, not of it. Okay? And so this society tells us you got to look a certain way, you got to measure up, and you better have your you-know-what together. And Jesus goes, hey, I actually need you to recognize your great need for me. And did I tell you yet that Jesus takes joy in when you need him? Have you ever encountered one of those dads that's just excited to teach his kid how to ride a bike? Like, I'm not a perfect dad. You can ask any of my 5 children. But when they need me, I just feel like good. Like, it feels really good to be like, oh, let me help you. And like, you know, my chest grows a little more. I know it's already pretty big. Did you know the Father, hear me on this, church. I know I'm being goofy today, but did you know he actually takes joy in when his children say, I need you. There's something that I've actually learned in my own life, and that is what I call practicing Hosanna. Like, every day, every moment that I need him, I cry out, Hosanna. I don't know if you're anything like me, but there's times that sometimes when I'm praying and talking to God and there's areas of my life that maybe I need him to help me with, it's kind of hard to remember those things. And so what I've done, I made it a practice, is in the moment, I go, God, this is it, Hosanna. Hey, this moment where I'm at my wit's end with my children, Hosanna. God, when I've got this friend that's going through this and I have no idea what to say to them, Hosanna. God, when I'm trying to build this business and to glorify you, I just don't know what the next step is, Hosanna. God, I'm facing this relationship issue that I can't figure it out, Hosanna.
I can't control myself. Hosanna. I don't have the answers. Hosanna. I need wisdom. Hosanna. Invite him into that moment and watch his salvation power go to work. I am telling you, my friend, he is faithful to respond. You know, but here's our problem, is that we live in a society that has taught us that difficulty means we aren't blessed. We have bought into a lie that goes, if something's going wrong, if I am uncomfortable, if I am in pain, if things are not looking the way, then I must not be blessed. I want to just flip that script and teach you that the upside down kingdom of God would say, difficulty is your greatest blessing. Because Paul would say in the book of Philippians that it is trials and tribulation that are going to be your direct route to hope. And some of us want hope, but we don't want the process of getting to a hope that does not disappoint. But I'm telling you, it's going to be the gut-wrenching, the difficulties, the trials that give you something, that produce something in you. But we want hope without the difficulty. And it's in that difficulty that we cry out, Hosanna, I am not okay, God. And he begins to go, I'll produce perseverance in you, and that's going to produce character, and character is going to give you hope. Oh, and by the way, if hope isn't good enough, it's a hope that won't disappoint you. That's good preaching right there. I thought I was going to get more amens. Here's the good news. I'm almost done. Are you getting something out of this today? That's really good. Here's the good news for you. All of us can cry out, Hosanna. That's good news. We can all recognize that the presence of the Savior is here and now. We can empty ourselves of ourselves and recognize, God, I'm not okay. I need some help. Hosanna. Cry out for mercy, and he will hear you. Cry out for wisdom, and he will give it. Cry out for salvation. Hear me on this, church. Even from the holes that you've dug yourself. Yes. You know, some of you are hearing me talk today, and you're like, yeah, Tony, but you don't know. No, you don't know. You have no idea the holes that I have dug. I'm telling you. You know, I think the reason why a lot of us are attracted to stories like Little Red Riding Hood and the Big Bad Wolf is because we all experience when that wolf appears. You know, we all experience when that darkness comes up, when we look at our past and we're ashamed, when we look at our past and we're depressed about it. And God's going, bring it all to me. That's really good news for you today. So seek him while he can still be found. Sophia, you can come on up. Charles Spurgeon, I spent all of 2023... By the way, I recommend this to you. There is a book called Spurgeon and the Psalms. And it's basically every psalm. And it begins with kind of a commentary from Charles Spurgeon, and it ends with sermons that he wrote from those psalms. And it I spent every day in 2023 going through that, and it was incredible. From this book, Spurgeon and the Psalms, as it relates to the Psalms that cry out for mercy and for salvation, Spurgeon says this: have mercy on me, O Lord. Memories of the past and confidences concerning the future conducted the man of God to the mercy seat to plead for the needs of the present. Sounds a little bit like our first point, doesn't it? His first prayer is one suitable for all persons and occasions. It breathes a humble spirit. indicates self-knowledge appeals to the proper attributes to the fitting person. Have mercy on me, O Lord. Just as Luther used to call some texts little Bibles, so we may call this sentence a little prayer book. For it has in it the soul and marrow of prayer. The latter looks to be short, but it reaches from earth to heaven. Consider my trouble from those who hate me, you who lift me up from the gates of death. What a noble title here is given to the Most High. What a glorious lift. In sickness, in sin, in despair, in temptation, we have been brought very low, and the gloomy portal has seemed as if it would open to imprison us. But underneath us were the everlasting arms. And therefore, we have been uplifted even to the gates of heaven. You cry out, and those arms will sustain you. You cry out, and his steady right hand will guide you. You cry out, and you come under the shadow of his wings. Come on, would God become the strong tower in which we run to? Come on, some of you, you gotta know he's the glory and the lifter of your head. Psalm 5:12 says this, you and I, the righteous, we're surrounded like a shield of favor. It may look and feel, and quite frankly, sometimes it is that you look everywhere and you're surrounded by trouble. The Word of God says you're also surrounded like a shield with his favor. Come on, we come under the shadow of his wings. And when we look to him, he not only hears us, but he responds, my friend. That is a good God who has good plans for his people. I think that's a good way for us to now turn our attention to a moment of response. And as you know, we always like to give you time to reflect on what God's been saying to all of us individually. So I want to encourage you today to take some time. What are the things that maybe you've got to empty yourself of? What are the things that you have been holding on to that you've got to go, okay, God, I take this off and here you go. What are the things that you've got to give over to him? My question is, maybe for some of us, the moment of reflection is to go, God, what are things I've literally missed out on? Who are the people I've missed because I've overlooked because I'm waiting for the next? What's the mission you've called me to right now that I've ignored because I'm waiting for the next thing? And God, help me recognize that I actually need you always. Not just sometimes, not just here and there, but I need you all the time, and I'm desperate for you. If you need prayer for anything today, I want to direct you to the cross in the back of the sanctuary today. By the way, we do this on purpose. I recognize maybe I haven't addressed this, but a while ago we changed the back. If you've been coming to Legacy Church, we changed the back from being a prayer corner to just calling it the cross. Because we actually want to always say, go to the cross. I want to direct you to the foot of the cross. Maybe today, the first time you approach the cross is because you're giving your life over to Jesus. Maybe today you've never given your life over to him, and you've never accepted him as your Lord and your Savior. And maybe you even have questions about that and you have no idea what that looks like. You can at any time leave your seat, head over to the cross, and there's two amazing, beautiful people that are willing to answer questions for you and pray with you. If you need prayer for anything else, you can at any time leave and go to the cross, and those people will pray with you and for you. As we reflect, I also would like to let you know that the communion tables are open here in the front and in the back. We do this every Sunday as a reminder of the broken body of Jesus Christ and his blood that was shed. Man, and it wrecks this pastor every time I think about that. But all of us here today have something to respond with as we look to the fact that Jesus is here and we don't want to miss out on what he's doing. So let me pray for you and then let's respond. Father, I thank you
for your word today. I thank you because you speak to all of us. I pray now that as we take a moment of reflection, for some of us, that's a moment of stillness and quiet where we allow you to speak to us. For some of us, it means we've got to go and talk to somebody, go get prayer for something. I pray that no matter what, God, that we would be quick to respond to you and your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's respond, church. Some of you are still taking time to respond. And so what we always do is we leave the sanctuary as a kind of a quiet and reverent place for anyone that's still getting prayer or still partaking communion or taking a moment of prayer and silence to do that. So for the rest of you, I want to thank you for being here and dismiss you. Have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your day. I have a couple of reminders real quick. Actually, I just realized. Number one, if you're a member, you know that today at 1 o'clock, we've got our annual finance report meeting here in the sanctuary. So I want to remind you of that. And then also want to remind you to invite for this next weekend. Let's pack this place out. Let's make sure that everyone gets to hear the greatest message that this world has ever heard. Love you all. You are dismissed. Again, take your conversations in the lobby, all that, so that we can keep this place a place of reverence for people that are still praying. Love you all.